All right, everyone, we are back. S4Y Vlogcast number 21. We are now in our 20s. We are all grown up. We have matured. And of course, it is myself, your humble and gracious host, Christian Soto, Matt Big Bet, Alpha Reg, Berkey himself, Arms of Steel. How are you doing?
I'm great, man.
It's a calm week now. I feel like things have settled down. There's new talking points that people want to hear about. Less possible, more of your ascending lifestyle to like being famous.
Yeah, go ahead. To what?
To famous. to fame.
To what? What
you are absolutely famous now. I told you like a couple years ago, I was like, I think you're like top five famous. And now you're like, nah. Now I know for sure you're top five famous.
For people who investigated Possel?
That's fair. You're part of the Justice League. That's what they said.
I'm one of the five most recognizable people who...
I'm sure... You know they have a list on like Hendon Mob, like popularity list? You ever checked it?
No.
You have to be up there this week.
I doubt it.
I mean, it has to be like Possel, Matt Berkey.
If Possel's number one, there is something wrong with our system.
It has to be. He has to be.
I'm Googling it. I need to know.
He has to be the most popular for sure.
I need to know.
Not even close.
I would bet if he's on the top five, none of the rest of us are on it.
If he's it's gonna be Possel, Doug Polk, Matt Berkey.
No, man. No way.
Mike Possel, number one. It's right there. Look,
got you. Wow, it is Mike Possel.
Mike Possel, Bryn Kenney, Dan and Negreanu never leaves the top five. And Veronica Brill.
There it is. Not me.
All right. So let's get into one of the talking points this week. Now that things have died down, I saw a tweet from you talking about the Venetian Lucky Shot Poker Tournament. And that kind of came and went. You know, the Apostle thing kind of took over.
They got a little lucky.
Yeah. They got a little lucky. But the event still hasn't happened. So it's on the verge of occurring. And let's talk a little bit about that. So I do have the tournament structure, but if you want to tell people a little bit about what your idea of what the tournament is and why it's not good, let's talk about it.
All right. So I don't want to spend too much time on this because I don't want to give a platform to something that I think is relatively shitty.
Yeah.
And also there just isn't a lot to say other than don't fucking play it.
Yeah.
It's a 150K guarantee where for every dollar they go over the guarantee, they get to keep that money. It does not go to the prize pool.
That is true.
I don't think there's going to be too much of a risk on the Venetians' end as far as not meeting the guarantee. I just really hope that people understand like the rake trap that they're falling into. You know, if they crush this guarantee and say get a $300,000 prize pool, that's just 150K off the top that the Venetian makes. You can't make that money back. It is just impossible. That is 50% rake. Or actually, I guess it's 100% rake.
So no, why are people, what's their pitch? Why is this incentivized for the Venetian?
What they're selling it as is an opportunity to get lucky. So I believe, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think what they have is a drawing of some sort or some other sort of contest where they're giving away cash prizes.
Correct.
So I think that by playing the event, you get entered into some sort of lottery where you can win upwards of like 50K through sheer chance. And, you know, that's great, but why would you contribute to a tournament prize pool in order to have, you know, a couple dollars worth of equity in this lottery?
Right. Yeah. Do you think that this is something that, if successful, will become adopted in other venues? Because that's, I think, the fear of the
community. Mean, sadly, like, that's always been the casino's motive, right, is how to separate the uneducated from their dollars.
Yeah, that's their business.
Yeah, and I mean, employing a high tax is the easiest way to do it.
Yeah, I mean, I hope that people don't show up. I obviously hope that, you know.
We hope that, though, when they put the bad beat in place and started taking $7 on a flop.
And yeah.
They still get more 2-5 action than most casinos in town.
That is true.
The problem is that they're appealing to uneducated people who aren't necessarily a big part of the community.
But is that a thing? Is that, that's always been one of the concepts now. Like this whole thing when we speak about rake, speak about, you know, one of the things that I heard even on the recent Bryn Kenney podcast with Joe Ingram was like, yeah, you know, like we have to figure out a new rake structure where like the winning players are giving a little bit back and like they're getting.
Well, they were speaking more so to the stars situation where they said it's okay to raise rake as long as it's going back to the losing players.
Right. So a lot of, you know, I think a lot of venues are trying to find different avenues of potentially increasing rake and finding a way to give it back. Maybe this is one of them. I guess I'm trying to play the other side of Venetian here. Obviously, Venetian doesn't have a historical track record of like looking out for the players, but maybe this is an attempt of saying, okay, well, we'll increase the rake for these winners, and maybe Baseball D won't win every single tournament at Venetian, and we'll give something back to these guys.
Right, but like we don't know what percentage of that rake will be going to the prizes of these giveaways. They could just be skinning the field alive. So let's say that throughout, I don't even know how many events like this they're running. Let's say it's just the one and they raise 150K extra. So they get double the guaranteed prize pool.
Yeah.
Let's say they put 100 of that back into the drawings. That's still an extra 50K in rake that they just taxed on a $300 buy-in.
Yeah. I mean, our doors are always open if Tommy does want to come here and talk to us and kind of explain why this is a good idea in comparison, because they have a successful series already. Mm-hmm. Like the Extravaganza series that they run, I think it's four times a year. It's a major thing in town. I'm not sure why they want to change.
I think there's just pressure from the top. Mm. There has to be, right? Because like in that example that I just gave, you're talking about them taking an extra 450 buy-ins out of the prize pool.
Yeah, that's wild.
And redistributing 300 of it. But they're still pocketing an extra 150 buy-ins. You can't replace those kinds of numbers.
Yeah.
Like at some point, you just won't find 450 customers. So you're kind of just like crippling the ecosystem in a way that makes it really hard to rebound. But if they're on a smash and grab type program where all they really care about is maximizing their room's profits until they shut down, then this is fine. And we think that that's similar to like what Stars' trajectory was until they sold.
That makes a lot of sense. All right, let's move into a different series that has begun this week. WSOP Europe. I want to talk a couple different things. So first thing, Dan Shack wrote a tweet today. Does anyone else think that WSOP is tarnishing the brand by having these WSOP Europe bracelet events like the 2500 8 game that would get 500 runners in Vegas giving away a bracelet to now a 50-man field with huge influence on player of the year?
Man, I love Dan, but he's just always like, I don't want to say whining, but he's whining a lot. For a billionaire, he has a lot of fucking gripes.
Hey, I mean,
I'm so tired of the tarnishing the brand argument when it comes to World Series events. Like, we get the biggest tournament field of all time and it's tarnishing the brand. Mm-hmm. We take it over to Europe and it's tarnishing the brand. We do it in Australia and it's tarnishing the brand.
But a 50-man field getting a bracelet.
Who gives a shit? There was a 200-man or a 120-man online field that got a bracelet, tarnishing the brand. Like, why does it tarnish the brand exactly?
The argument is the World Series, the bracelet is a meaningful thing. It is not it's a coveted item for players, it's a coveted item for recreational players. It's something that you can say you've made it in a way.
First, who do you think it's more coveted for? Pros or recs?
Well, I think it's more coveted for recs.
It's not even close.
I think pros still want a bracelet. Okay.
Going down that path.
Okay.
Is Daniel Negreanu in Europe right now?
Yes.
Is Phil Hellmuth in Europe right now?
Yes.
Is ODB in Europe right now?
Yes.
Are these guys top tier pros?
Yes.
Okay. What are we tarnishing exactly?
Okay.
These guys are there chasing a player of the year race that is absolutely fundamentally meaningless. They get nothing.
Right.
They get a pat on the back and a banner in the Rio.
The legacy.
Sure.
Right.
So it's tarnished.
Let's say this thing was close. Let's say this thing was close, right? Sure. And it is right now, right? And let's say that the winning event was a 50-man field, 2,500 event. It feels as if that shouldn't be the differentiating factor right now.
But why? They battled it out for an entire summer. They all have the opportunity to play this 50-man tournament.
Right.
Where I agree with you is whenever it's like the 250K that separates the winner from the loser.
They didn't include that this year.
Which is great.
But only because it was a late addition to the schedule.
Even if they had included it, as much as I think that that becomes a little problematic, it's still, if given notice, is a part of the chase. Like, nobody's going to say, hey, we shouldn't include 10Ks because this guy who's crushing the 1500 level can't afford to play.
Have we just lost this allure then? If it's because that's something, there's has to bracelet? Be. Do I want a bracelet?
Yeah.
Yes, of course.
Me too.
Yeah. Okay.
No. In my career, they've given away like 125 bracelets.
But once a bracelet doesn't
1,000 to 1,200 bracelets.
But once a bracelet doesn't become a rarity, it loses its legacy.
It's never a rarity. It hasn't been a rarity since 2001.
When you began your career, there was a lot less bracelets awarded a year. Now there's plentiful, like maybe 3x.
It's less than double. No.
Oh.
There was certainly 30 plus events when I first started.
Okay. We're going to have to look this one up. We're going to need a researcher here, you know? All right. So
my first World Series was 2006, but I started playing in 2003. I would bet
2003
had at least 20 events.
There's 90 bracelet events this year.
There was 36 in 2003.
Okay. So 90. There was 90 this year.
Okay.
That's a lot.
But this year is up like 30% from last year where there was like...
This was only the summer too. So now if we include a little bit of this,
sure.
You know, we're looking at maybe like 100.
Okay, great.
So that's 3X.
And there are 75 or 8,000 people playing the main event that all want a bracelet. So that means
I'm with you, man. I'm not saying that that means it's not a thing that matters, but
that means 0.1% of people are going to vie for a bracelet.
If there was there has to be a number where it's like, okay,
there isn't. Just the more bracelets that come to be, or the more accessible they are to acquire, just makes the number that you acquire more important.
Well, yeah, of course. I mean,
right? Like this is like talking about chasing the home run record in baseball.
Mm-hmm.
As hitters became bigger, faster, stronger, and more importantly, like the PED era and everything else, people want to throw an asterisk up and say like, oh, it was tarnished and everything else. But it's like, well, was it? Or are athletes in 2019 just far superior to athletes in 1952?
Yes, but we don't see, like, the PED era still happened.
Right, but the pitchers were also on PEDs, mm-hmm. and home runs are still astronomically high now compared to 100 years ago or the dead ball era or whatever the case may be. And if you look sports-wide, records are constantly broken,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, yeah, there are some greats that made unattainable ones, at least in the short run. DiMaggio's streak is unlikely to be broken anytime soon. Cal Ripken's Ironman streak might not be broken anytime soon. But the thing is at some point, the game itself will evolve in such a way like for instance, baseball. Bonds' home run record may not even be safe now. With the launch angle and the implied value of hitting a home run now versus singles going drastically up, like as data improves, as the evolution of the game evolves, we're just going to see more incentive to shatter things like this. And you're going to see less incentive to break a record like Cal Ripken's consecutive game streak, because now it's all about health, not necessarily getting out there and grinding day in and day out.
I'm a fan of the World Series of Poker Europe because I'm on it, you know?
Sure. By comparison, there are very few WPTs.
Yeah, that's why WPTs are coveted.
I don't think they're any more coveted than a bracelet.
They're not more coveted than a bracelet today because the bracelet still remains with that allure. But WPT titles are very like prestigious at this point.
I wouldn't give prestige to either one of them. I mean, and that's not a shot at either brand. It's just it's the pulse of the community right now. High rollers are what are highly regarded. Right?
Yeah.
None of the people in the top 10, I don't even know if you would know if they're a WPT champ or not.
Mm.
You would know if they have a bracelet or not, though. Mm. Trophies aren't worth anything. I mean, look at a guy like Mercier.
But that's the thing. Like, we're trying to develop characters. We're trying to develop storylines. This is what we need in the game to grow the game. And then, but for that to happen, we need these, like, things. Like, these things that are coveted.
It needs to be more than a one-off. It needs to be, there needs to be coordination, right? The WPT needs to be a league, not a tour. Mm. The WSOP needs to be a festival, not just, you know, for lack of better terminology, a business, mm-hmm. right? Like, at the end of the day, they're still a corporation, and they're certainly worried about their bottom line. They're worried about attracting new players, and they do a great job of it. But if we want to get into the media side of things and growing the health of the game and creating superheroes out of your professionals and getting back to the days of yore, whenever the moneymakers and the Scott Fishmans and the crew were out and about flaunting in front of cameras and stuff like that, for that stuff to happen, this needs to be converted into a business greater than patrons and industry that serves, right? It needs to be a coordination of the two. The big thing separating the WWE from the WSOP is that the WWE, it's a business within a business, right? The wrestlers aren't customers. The wrestlers are talent.
Right.
And the back of the house, the corporation, the name, the whatever you want to call it, is the entity. The customers are the viewers. Well, that's not how poker works. Mm-hmm. The business side of things, the brand, the name, that's just all who's in the service side of things. The customer itself is the player. Now there is no talent in accordance to how the structure works.
Correct.
And the viewer gets left behind because they're supposed to be the consumer, but in all regards, they're just an afterthought.
So this is what we need to do. This is what Software Wide needs to do.
I mean, I think this is what Poker Central is trying to do, but again, the problem is that they're third party.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like, at the end of the day, you can form as many partnerships as you want, but there's still a hard separation between the business entities and the quote-unquote consumer. Right now, the players are still the consumers across the board. Whether you're talking about Poker Central as a media outlet, Poker News as a media outlet, or WSOP, WPT as branding affiliates. The end of the day, there's no partnership whatsoever between the players and all of these entities.
So what do you think the first step is?
I think the margins are, at the end of the day, relatively narrow. And somebody has to be willing to take a bath up front. Somebody has to be willing to say, like, I'm going to operate at a deficit for 5 to 10 years in order to build out this massive model where I have players working for me in order to put out a consumer product. Mm. But I think the problem is that the vision for the consumer product is very blurry. And because of that, you now lose the brands. Because ultimately, like, you know, again, WPT and WSOP being the two biggest of the two, they're the kind of like clearance houses that would be the ones to embrace all of this, or that would need to embrace all this stuff and effectively develop leagues, mm-hmm. right? So, like, and this is already kind of happening just due to the nature of the cost of buying.
That's like CFL?
Nah, I mean, Triton might be the NFL, right? Like,
Triton's balling right
yeah.
now.
Yeah. But yeah, it's like there's already this segregation by buy-ins. So effectively, like, Triton would probably be the best place to test all of this because it's so few moving parts. Because it's such a high threshold to cross already that they're dealing with very, very few consumers at the moment, or what would eventually become talent. So yeah, I mean, until somebody's willing to take a huge loss and try to figure out a way to turn this into something bigger, we're just going to stay status quo.
WSOP is in Europe currently, as we mentioned earlier.
You're on the ones and twos.
And the first event they decided to let me in was a $250,000 tournament, which is a little bit scary because I'm like, well, these guys maybe are better than me.
They're just richer, man.
It was Tuckman, Brent Hanks, and myself. It's interesting to, especially at that level, at least, to see that the strategy that we are like kind of developing and stuff still holds true there. Cause like a lot of times I'm like, I would like say like, okay, I think he's going to do this. Like, I think he's going to block better. I think he's going to do this. And then it actually happens. And that's kind of nice. Not only for the viewer who's like, oh, okay, this, maybe, you know, I know what I'm talking about, but like also for me, like, oh, okay. Like these high level players are kind of thinking at least somewhat in the same wavelength as me. And that brings me to a question of, are these live streams good as it pertains to learning? So if, like, because there's a lot to be said in terms of like, you know, there was a little bit of controversy in the summer, you know, with the Nick Schulman thing of like, yeah. You know, but is watching the best players still one of the best ways of learning?
I think the commentary matters far more than the play.
Okay.
And I don't even think it's remotely close. I would compare this similarly to Poker Out Loud as a learning tool compared to watching a live stream. If we just got six people that couldn't really articulate their thoughts or weren't thinking whenever they were taking action,
yeah,
there would be nothing to learn,
okay,
at all. And the same holds true whenever watching a stream. Even if you have the best players in the world on display, if you're not already thinking in range versus range terms, then watching them execute is going to be relatively meaningless to you unless you have a good interpreter.
Yeah, I think that's really what it is, because everything, like, as I'm watching, everything has a meaning. So, like, the bet size they make is representative of a certain section of their range. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's not clear to everybody watching. So it's like, when I see that bet size, I'm like, okay, he's not saying he has this. He's saying he has this.
Right.
You know, and even that little nuance is a big deal, because it's kind of a communication of, like, what the player is trying to say.
Yeah. I think we talk about this a lot where, you know, the universal language worldwide is math, but we have a very difficult time interpreting it from numbers to actual language. Mm-hmm. And a lot gets lost in that interpretation. I think the same holds true whenever we talk about, well, maybe even to a deeper level, game theory and then how it applies to poker. You're effectively taking quantitative analysis in mathematical terms and in that mathematical language, trying to then convey it into a speakable language that is riddled with jargon. Mm-hmm. and kind of like poker speak.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, have a conversation that is now in line with the actions that took place. So we have this complete spectrum where an action happens due to math.
Yes.
Right? Every single play made by a high-level player is some sort of very deeply refined calculation.
Yes.
Right? Now, as the viewer, your job is to interpret that calculated move, convey it into poker speak, and then from poker speak, bring it full circle and say, this is the story that he's trying to tell.
Yeah.
Through the actions that he's taking. And there's a lot of points where you can just get lost or dilute the actual, like teachable moment.
And that's always the balance. Like the balance for me that is really difficult is getting these high level plays, interpreting them, both in understanding them, because they're very good players. So mm-hmm. I'll have to be kind of on it. Like then on top of that, not speak in such a way that's boring to the people listening in like just complete jargon, as if I'm talking to a student or something, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, so that trend, and then also making myself humble enough to not make it seem like I could just do that play.
Right.
So those three things are happening simultaneously, which is like really hard, at least for me.
There's a lot of things that you inherently understand at one level or the other, either at the mathematical level or at the language level. Mm-hmm. Of what's taking place in game. So there are a lot of things that you can convey through poker speak that makes perfect sense to you and would make perfect sense to somebody who thinks like you, but because maybe you don't necessarily understand the math behind it, mm-hmm. it doesn't get communicated to everyone.
Right.
And vice versa. There's plenty of plays sure. where you absolutely inherently understand the math, but you don't have the proper words or language to interpret it. Mm-hmm. And now as you're like trying, and I'm not saying you, but I'm just saying
the general job.
Of yeah. That, people, yeah. people in, well, everybody really like, yeah. it's what hinders people from learning. Right. When they're trying to communicate their point, they can recognize like, okay, mathematically I have to do X, Y, or Z, but I can't really communicate why that's true. And, you know, ultimately, like, these are the problems that I set out to solve whenever we developed this company, was marrying those two points together. When we talk about having a why-centric point of view, the whole purpose behind that is to identify the what's and the hows in the problem-solving metrics and figure out a way that we can convert them into speakable language and have such inherent knowledge that it works both directions. Now we have a purpose that we can communicate as well as a fundamental path towards achieving said purpose through the math or through the language.
All right. So if the people want to listen to me, I'll be on there pretty much every single day until Halloween. Not everything will be a 250K. I don't know how I'm going to do in the short deck, but I'll be on there. So tune in, pokergo.com. All right. That brings me into the next talking point, which is a pretty good transition to what you're saying. Bryn Kenney, number one player in the world, was on.
Number one gangster.
Number one gangster in the world. I like Bryn Kenney. I appreciate the way he plays No Limit Hold'em.
You know what I like about you liking Bryn?
What?
Is that you're just young enough where Bryn is, he's still this like unblemished hero.
Yeah.
Like he had some struggles, but as far as you know, he's just always been on top. I know 18-year-old Bryn from Turning Stone firing in the 2-5-10 uncapped game. Where, like, you know, I've seen this kid run up a million and run down a million in, like, weeks.
That's the crazy part about it. I think that's what kind of...
Like, there are two Bryns.
Oh, I see.
There's, like, pre-Black Friday Bryn and then, like, you know, High Roller Bryn.
Yeah, I only met High Roller Bryn. This is why I don't never meet my heroes.
But he's always been hood. He's always been super... I actually wrote... One of my very first blogs that I ever wrote was for this forum called Donkey Fish Poker. And it doesn't exist anymore, but the founder was Rob Croak, the guy who created Silly Bands.
Yeah, I remember.
And I started writing for them in like 2005, I think. And one of the very first articles that I ever wrote was a trip report that I had from Turning Stone.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember writing in it that this 2-5-10, so it was a $2, $5, $10 game, right? It was a 300 minimum buy-in, no cap. I don't know if you remember this guy, probably not, but his name was Al Crux. Okay. He went deep in the main event in like 2005 or something. Local legend. I mean, just a hero in Syracuse, New York area.
Mm-hmm.
He was the host of the game.
Okay.
And because it was 18 and over, all the online crowd came. So it was like the regulars that we would often see were like, this is where I met Al Berry.
It was like Boosted J and those guys?
No. Boosted J, I didn't meet till I was much older. Bonomo, Bryn, Yellow Sub. Justin Schwartz, Stealth Monk.
Wow.
Action Jeff was another kid that used to come. He was massive sit and go grinder. Let me think. Doc Sands, this is where I first met him. Chrissy B, this is where I first met her.
Wow, this is a legendary group.
So this 2-5-10 game would be like me.
Sounds soft.
At the time, it felt like it. So it was like all these online kids, and they were all so rich, right? And then it would be mixes of like local older guys. So like Al Crux is like 45 and they're just in there punting. And there was a couple other punters like from my local casino that would always come up and things like that. So I wrote this article and I said, this is a future Bobby game. This game is the future of Bobby's room.
Right.
And I was just like positive that this was like what the high stakes community was going to look like. Seaver may have been there too.
It
was literally everybody who ultimately rose to high stakes. Now, some fell off. There's a bunch of them I'm not naming that like just never made it.
Right.
But why I'm laughing is because Doc Sands was in the game, as was Chrissy a lot. And at the time, we all knew Doc Sands as Dave. He wasn't Doc Sands. Like nobody called him. Nobody called anybody by their online monikers, I don't think. So he was just Dave. But his thing was... that he would just constantly, I mean, we put in sessions, man. We're talking like 20 plus hours. And he would just constantly get up from the table and just start doing push-ups in the middle of the casino.
No, I've seen this.
Oh yeah, Brent was in this game
no,
too.
No, wait. I've seen Doc Sands do this at the Wynn. Okay? He still does it today. Okay,
so I don't know if he knows this, but for a decade, we called him Push-Up Dave.
All right.
That was the only thing he was referred to
as. Now he does headstands at the Wynn. I'm at this table. He's at this table right behind me.
Yeah.
And then he just gets up and does a fucking headstand or like however that's called, hands with the,
yeah.
the whole thing.
Yeah, it's crazy because like I didn't realize it at the time.
I almost just want to go like that.
He was like coming all the way from Montana. I think Chrissy was in Toronto, so she probably wasn't that far away. Bryn was coming from New York, so like, you know, another 4 hours. We were coming from Pennsylvania. It was like 6 hour drive. Mm-hmm. Everybody was just like coming for this Empire State Championship every single year. I think it was twice a year. And we just get massive. And it was like...
That's crazy.
Honestly, it was like what PCA ultimately evolved into.
Yeah. RIP PCA. All right. So, want to say something that was interesting as it pertains to one of the quotables of Bryn Kenney's pod with Joe Ingram. He said, I'm trying to solve for the problem of right now, and they're trying to solve for the problem that they think always exists.
Mm-hmm.
As it pertains to his poker strategy.
Yeah. I like that. It's actually a pretty deep line that deserves a little bit of dissection. So effectively what he's trying to say is that he's making real-time decisions based upon all of the variables that are confronted to him.
Mm-hmm.
And they're trying to solve for the general case with a problem that's never,
general.
Well, not only that, but like, with effectively a problem that persists. Mm. So the way he views poker, and I really like this, is that each problem is unique. It'll have properties of other problems similar that you've solved.
Right.
But each and every single spot that you find yourself in is unique to the last. Where what he's basically saying about the, I don't even know what to label them, the solver community. I don't know. I don't know what to say without sounding insulting because I don't mean to be. I mean them no disrespect. It's just they have a different approach.
Yeah.
So let's call them the analytics community. I think that's the best approach, right? Because they're very data-driven. They're making quantitative decisions based on very large numbers of simulations and extrapolations, right? So what Bryn's basically saying is that he has a strong enough fundamental understanding of the principles that drive decision-making in-game that he will approach each problem set uniquely and rely upon those principles in order to arrive at a solution.
Mm.
And oftentimes that'll lead him taking a contrarian approach compared to what the analytics community would say is perfect or correct or whatever you want to call it. And what they're doing is they're solving for the general case.
Yes.
So in that instance, they're batching problem sets. And they're basically saying like, well, this problem looks similar to another problem. So let's lump them all together and solve for the average case. And that's great if you can distill the game down to a solvable point. But in essence, we haven't. So that poses problem number one. Number two is that could be overcome if, like Bryn, you have this fundamental skill set, which is definitely true of the top,
mm-hmm.
right? The best of the best in the world definitely know everything that Bryn knows. There's no real separation there.
I'm not sure, man.
There might be an execution difference.
I'm going to fight for Bryn's side. I don't think that Bryn and Christoph Vogelsang view the game at all similarly.
I don't think they view the game similarly. I think they know the same principles.
I think that in terms of like whatever live exploitative things, I don't think Christoph even opens that door.
I agree. But I don't think that that's...
You don't think that's a principle?
Well, I don't think it's demonstrative of a scope of knowledge.
I
think it's where the path diverges between a unique specific problem versus a batched group of problems. Effectively, like we still arrive at the same two doors, right? The only difference is that when Bryn finds himself in a spot, he's literally going to solve for that spot given that positional dynamic versus that specific opponent with the stack depth that they're sitting at. Christoph will extrapolate. He'll say, okay, I've studied a bunch of sims or a number of sims that represent this problem in some capacity.
Correct.
Yeah. And I'm gonna solve for the average case. So because they're coming from two very studied positions, just two different studied positions, one's more kinesthetic, one's more analytic, they're still going to arrive at pretty good solution sets. Where this deteriorates is... when you get players who aren't as talented as Christoph, right? Now, they don't necessarily have that same set of principles built up. And you don't necessarily derive them just from reading a bunch of data.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where Polk and I kind of had friction. He was basically saying that, like, if you hand somebody a strategy and just say, implement this, they'll learn. And they'll learn why each play works.
Right.
And I was kind of pushing back saying, like, that's not true.
I agree.
I think it's less likely that the general case people reverse engineer problems like that. I think in unique senses that happens. I think Bryn's very good at that. I think I'm very good at that. I think Nick Howard's very good at that. I think you're very good at that. But I don't think we represent the general case.
Well, yeah.
Which is why I think population gravitates towards I need answers.
That makes sense. What are your thoughts in terms of, like, he said one more thing in terms of, like, how he studies the game is more he just kind of thinks. Like, he just, like, sits there and, like, thinks about the game, not necessarily with, like, a solver, not necessarily with hand histories, but just, like, thinks, like, okay, like, this is the problem that happened today. How could I have done this better? Like, what if I did this? How does he react, etc.? Not necessarily like what the modern strategy is.
Well, he spoke a little bit more specifically than that, and it really resonated with me because this has always been kind of my philosophy and approach. He basically said that, like, what he'll do is he'll spend a lot of time thinking deeply and critically about what the proper strategy, counter strategy should be
mm-hmm.
for certain game dynamics.
Yeah.
And not in a minute way, but in a simplistic way. Or I guess in a holistic way is a better descriptor. So if your opponent is, if their tendencies lie in this particular framework, then what counter strategy can we employ that could potentially lead them to mistakes? So this was a lot easier in the past because people had less of a framework to operate off of. They had less construction. So we could easily identify when they were overdoing something. This opponent over three bets. Therefore, I'm going to raise in a more polar manner and I might work in a limp range. This opponent under three bets. Therefore, I'm going to raise wider. We could simply see those things and observe and be very good at it. So Bryn's approach becomes a lot more difficult now that people are a lot more in line, but we still have a general sense for where triggers are pulled,
mm-hmm.
right? So if we go back to like how we studied for the Super High Roller Bowl in 2016, we could still pick up on some trend, on some, like, I guess, trend lines, if you will, where when faced with a flop c-bet of 33%, the expectation was almost never a double barrel. So it was either bet, check, or it was bet, bet, bet.
Correct.
And those were really the only two lines being employed.
Right.
So the way that we would split was we would just massively overfold the turn
mm-hmm.
and put them in negative EV river spot.
Correct.
And it worked really well.
Yeah.
And that's just a matter of observation.
Welcome.
Thanks. That's just a matter of observation and then thinking critically about, like, what are the common strategies employed and what are the counter strategies. And I think that even though it's a little tougher now because strategies are more protected, Bryn can do this and do this well just because at the end of the day, people are still mimicking, especially in such a tight niche environment or tight knit environment, right? There's still going to be strategy leaders or thought leaders in that little tiny community. And then there's going to be this mimicking effect that takes place thereafter.
Yeah.
So if Bryn can just spot like who the mimickers are, and recognize like where the mimicking process goes wrong because they don't know what the thought leader knows, he immediately has an exploit.
Yeah.
He immediately has a counter strategy.
He says he could tell if a person's lying.
And we all say that as poker players.
I mean, he said it though. He's like, I just look at him, man. Like, I just look at him and I know. Like,
I bet I could lie to Bryn.
All right, well, we have a bet.
We do have a bet.
Yeah, you and Bryn.
Nah, we have a bet.
I'm trying to get through this course, and now you want to divert me, but go ahead.
All right. So I went and got my biometrics measured today.
Nice.
Got my body fat measured mm-hmm. And my basal metabolic rate. So effectively like what my fasted metabolic rate is in order to keep me alive. Lost 5% body fat, and my metabolism went from slow to normal.
That's cool.
Good things.
Yeah.
It was over a 3-year period, however.
Yeah, but you didn't know when those switches occurred.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So with that being said, I've been goading you with this for a while. I said that I thought I could lose half my body fat before you.
Yeah.
I'm less confident because I'm a little lower than I thought I was. I'm 18. I thought I was closer to 20. And I know that doesn't seem like a big difference.
No, those last two is big.
Sub 10 is way different than 10.
Yeah.
But you got a little swag in your step. You said that you guarantee you're a huge favorite.
Yeah, I think you wanted to give me 7-1 or something crazy.
All right, so where this conversation ended up going was not me versus you any longer, but just whether or not you could do it.
Yeah.
And I think you're a huge dog. I said, I think the closer to 35% body fat you are, the more the proper odds are probably like 7.5-1. And the more above 35% you are, the more I think that like you're maybe 20-25% to make it. So you're going to get tested.
How much is this bet?
How much do you want to bet?
I don't know. It has to be large.
It has to be large. You're getting laid massive odds.
I will do this bet for $5,000 on my side.
I would bet you. So if you're above 35%, I'll lay you 5-1 at 5K.
Why are you trying to go broke, man? Why are you trying to go broke, man? Please. Why are you trying to shoot yourself in the foot?
I'll be an old. First of all, we have to put a timeline on it. Otherwise, I'll just never get to collect.
You know how much money? You know how much I like money?
I don't know. I know how much you like Sonic.
I like Sonic, but I like money.
We're going to find out. So we have to put a timeline on it. We don't have to do it right now, but we definitely. And that should obviously sway the odds. If it's 5 years, you're going to get way worse price.
Well, yeah. I mean,
if it's 1 year.
But then I also age. So that kind of evens it out.
You're 30.
Yeah, but still.
I lost 5% between 34 and 37. I don't think you're sweating it too much.
All right. Well.
But yeah, I'll do 5K.
All right, man. This guy's crazy. Well, you all let me know what you think. What are the odds? You want to invest? You want to take more money? It's fine. And if they want to take your side, that's fine. I'll probably bet 10K. I might bet pretty big. I don't know. If the community can escrow, I will take more money.
I think you can get action.
I hope so.
Maybe not at 7.5-1. I think I'm being a little generous there. But I also think that, like, you know, if you come in at like 34%, I think you getting to 17 is going to be way harder than you could ever imagine.
Yeah, I mean, just don't eat.
Nah. Yeah. That'll get you to 25.
Nah, then I won't eat again.
Nah, you'll be dead.
Nah, I won't die. I won't die. There's someone that fasted for a year.
That's fine.
That's fine. At some point, you just die or make money. That's how it is, you know? All right, so the next talking point is Jay Carver's deal in terms of streaming Thursday night NFL football games on the Run It Up platform. This was reported by Poker Central earlier this week after Jay Carver was on their podcast after they had the whole like Run It Up week on Poker After Dark.
Yep.
So Jay Carver is scheduled to stream 5 games beginning on week 10. Oakland Raiders versus Chargers, Steelers versus Browns, Texans versus Colts, Bears versus Cowboys, Ravens, Jets.
And he's doing commentary?
Mm-hmm. It's
Are there any details for this deal?
Not much, except that Carver has said he's going to brush up on his NFL insights because he doesn't know much. But okay, effectively, it's going to be streaming on his platform.
This is mostly to incentivize sports bets.
I assume he has a big sports betting audience, so I see why the NFL would be intrigued in like beginning to open that platform up.
I just wonder if they gave permission or if they actually struck a deal.
That's interesting. Carver did not release those statements, but I assume that he's not doing it for free. So
I mean, he'd be incentivized to. That's pretty massive if he can. Mm-hmm. You know, bring think about the implications there. Mm-hmm. They're basically saying like, we'll allow you to compete with NFL Network and I think it's NBC that do the Thursday night games. We'll allow you to be a third party competitor. I mean, that seems like a really big deal. Those networks pay big dollars.
So I think what happened is that Twitch and the NFL struck a deal. And then Twitch assigned
Carver. Way different. Okay. Okay, if that's, I mean, the Carver's still incentivized to do it for free, but I imagine that he also has a partnership with Twitch where they're probably working something out.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we're not trying to count Carver's money. Like, do your thing, young boy.
Yeah, sure.
But how does this affect, like, the transition? Like, we're seeing someone move from poker to mainstream commentary now. Mm-hmm. This is a big deal. This is not poker. You've elevated yourself through the stratosphere now. This is NFL. This is like the American way. This is not even like, this is huge.
Yeah.
He will be the number one in Hendemann popularity. Take you down to 11.
I like 11. That's my favorite number.
All right. Well, 12.
I think Jason's vision is really strong. I've never really been able to see the path to bringing it to fruition. But I don't think I need to or anybody else, because it's one of those things where once you start with a broad vision like what he had, where, you know, his idea was figuring out the best way to utilize the Twitch platform in order to both propel himself.
A platform. This is interesting because he tested multiple platforms.
Right. Twitch was the most up and coming. And honestly, I think that if he was, I don't know, 18 months later, all of this would be on YouTube.
Well, he was on YouTube before.
That's what I'm saying, but he was premature. YouTube kind of struck after Twitch, right? YouTube Live came years after Twitch was already popular. And, you know, don't get me wrong, gaming is still much more popular on Twitch than anywhere else. But we haven't really seen how the bridge is going to connect between poker and gaming yet. And I don't know that Jay Carver seems to be leaning more into sports than he would be in the esports side of things.
Yeah, we'll see. I think this is going to be really interesting, even seeing someone that I'm used to hearing as it pertains to poker now in a different avenue of sports, which is huge. I think that's a really big deal, and I hope he does well. You know, get your money, young man.
Yeah, I think the real unique thing is how different the audience will be compared to like what NFL Network would get on a Thursday night. So Jay Carver kind of gets to be himself and not have to bend into the mold of a Troy Aikman or a Tony Romo or some other analyst, right? No. He just kind of gets to be the sports bettor doing commentary on the Thursday night game. So he can take that angle, which is pretty liberating, especially given like how wrong a lot of the analytics are when it comes to football. You know, we won't have to suffer through a 4th-and-1 play where the analyst and the color are debating on whether or not it's a punt or a field goal opportunity, when he can just be like, this is a layup, go for it spot.
Let me ask you something about kind of this role of color analysts. Like, I feel like Daniel Negreanu had a poll the other day about commentary, and he was trying to say, like, there's so many different roles in commentary, and most people don't even know what the difference between Stapes and Tuckman and Shulman and Ali, like all these people are actually different as it pertains to their roles.
Well, the irony is that they're, I thought you were trying to lump them all together as like what they do, but that even that spectrum is very different.
That's what I'm trying to say.
So Stapes works with, I can't remember his name on the EPT. They mostly do a lot of the EPTs and the Stars events.
I know who it is. I forget his name too.
Yeah, he's British.
But he's very good.
They're a great, great duo.
And they have like a back, you know, a lot of people don't know that they have someone like in their ear kind of talking their little bit strategy. Strategy.
So in that particular pairing, there isn't technically an analyst.
Mm-hmm.
Stapes is more like color and... I'm embarrassed that I don't know the other guy's name.
Harrington is his name.
I don't think so.
I forget.
But anyway, his main role is to call the action.
Yes.
Right. So it's a lighter version of commentary, and sometimes they'll get like Lex in there who actually become the strategy side of things. But yeah, so you know, effectively, like in any given broadcast booth, what is 100% necessary is somebody to call the action.
Mm-hmm.
Now, quite often that's going to be a color commentary guy.
Yeah.
And what they mean by color commentary is just effectively somebody who's going to provide color to what you're watching, right? They're going to give you a non-boring description of what's taking place on screen.
Yeah.
Now, sometimes, Like in the instance of like Lon and Norm, they both in essence are color commentators, but Lon's job is specifically to call the action. Norm's job is specifically to hit the punchline.
Yeah.
You know? And in recent years, they actually brought in an analyst.
Right.
Like now,
Antonio.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. Now, the analyst role by default kind of fell to Norm, but the way he analyzed was just kind of through jokes, right? Yeah. It wasn't like high level analysis because in the early 2000s, that wasn't necessary. And they're great for that reason. As you start to look at some of the newer pairings, like when you're talking about Ali and Shulman,
yes.
What you'll often find, and you know, you can lump Tuckman into this, I would lump you into this, and I think Brent is probably another good person to exemplify this, is they can play both roles. So, you know, specifically like you and Brent, and even Ali to a pretty big degree, you're able to be both color and analyst at the same time. If for no other reason, then you have a lot of playing experience.
Right.
Now, there's going to be a sliding scale there. No offense to Ali, but I think you're going to do a better job analyzing than he would.
Right.
And no offense to you, but I think he's going to do a much better job at color than you.
Of course, of course.
But, you know, the reason why that versatility is fantastic is because it allows you, or allows the producers, a lot of options. So they can run Ali out there by himself at a poker after dark.
And they have.
Right. And yeah. And a lot of times they should. It's a great product with just one commentator because the table talk does tend to be a little bit more on the interesting side. Now, whenever you get into a high roller scenario, Ali would be drowning. And not because, you know, he's not capable, but more so just because there's nothing else to rely on.
Yes.
When you're flying solo like that, you need something in the environment to like get a breath in, right? Mm-hmm. That's where you insert analysts like Nick, right? Yeah. And, you know, there's a short list of people who I think do a really great job of fulfilling the analyst role.
Yeah,
agree. And you know, to call them one-trick pony is unfair, but, like, that's their specialty.
Yes.
So a guy like Shulman is strictly an analyst should never be anything else, and he's the fucking best at it.
Yeah, absolutely. Right?
And I think there are a lot of other people who fall under that skill set. I think Daniel is a good analyst. I think Olivia Biscay was a really great analyst.
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm, you know, going back, like, I'm glad I got the opportunity, and I'm very thankful for PokerGo giving me that shot. But yeah, it's interesting to see how there's just different roles and how people just lump them all together, but they're all very different, you know, and that I think that becomes like a really big thing. All right. So you're now number 10 in popularity. We'll see how you are next week. I think you're going up. That's what I think.
Postle's over, man.
Postle's over, which
Postle's
means
over. I didn't win no tournaments.
Yeah, but like I feel as if you're becoming like the face of poker.
I don't know where you're getting this nonsense.
I told you this 5 years ago, and it's becoming more and more
true. You can't
true
read
every
a
day.
Handful of YouTube comments and all of a sudden think that we got the world by the balls.
I think that, you know, you and Doug Polk are friends now. He is going to leave the game. The game, you know, the old guard is not talking anymore. It just leaves you, Batman. That's who you are. You're fucking Batman of poker.
You either die, you know, a hero or live long enough to become an enemy.
Yeah, during the day you run a business and at night you go fuck people up. That's what you're doing. That's it. You have that role. You're fucking Batman.
I'm going to have to get to that 9%.
All right, well, I hope you all enjoyed vlogcast number 21. Subscribe, like, you know, we don't do this for free, even though we haven't charged you yet. With that said, we're out of here.